Καλημέρα σας.
Good afternoon. Unfortunately, we cannot hear the speaker. There seems to be some issue with the microphone. There is some issue with the sound. We cannot hear the speaker.
Τηλέφωνα. Τι εννοείτε?
So now we can hear you. Now we can hear you, yes. Not there is. No, unfortunately, again, the microphone was cut. We cannot hear the lady using. We cannot hear.
Κλασικών σπουδών στην Αθήνα είναι ένα πολιτιστικό στολίδι της Αθήνας με σχεδόν 150.000 σπάνια βιβλία, αρχεία, πολύτιμα αρχεία και εκατοντάδες χειρόγραφα και έργα τέχνης αναδεικνύει την πολιτιστική κληρονομιά της Ελλάδας. Με πυρήνα τη μοναδική συλλογή του Ιωάννη Γεναδίου, ο οποίος ήταν διπλωμάτης και πρέσβης στο Λονδίνο. Η συλλογή αναδεικνύει τη διαχρονικότητα του ελληνισμού από την αρχαιότητα ως τις μέρες μας και η βιβλιοθήκη είναι το σπίτι εντός εισαγωγικών πολλών ερευνητών και μελετητών και φιλελλήνων και Ελλήνων που μελετούν την ιστορία της ελληνικής γραμματείας, το Βυζάντιο, την ιστορία της Ορθοδοξίας, το διαφωτισμό και την Ελληνική Επανάσταση, τη χαρτογραφία, αλλά ακόμα και τη χλωρίδα και την πανίδα της Ελλάδας. Από την ίδρυσή της, το 1926, η Γεναδίους υπήρξε πόλος έλξης αρχείων, που τώρα φυλάσσονται στο Τμήμα Αρχείων της Αμερικανικής Σχολής, του Ερίκου Σλίμαν, που έκανε ανασκαφές στην Τρία και στις Μυκήνες, της ιστορικής οικογένειας Δραγούμη, του Γιώργου Σεφέρη και του Οδυσσέα Ελίτη, που έχουν πάρει...
Ο Σεφέρης, Οδυσσέας Ελίτης, and many leading writers of the 30th generation. Two out of our most important archives are connected to music. The first belongs to the conductor Dimitris Mitropoulos and the rest to Ilias Petropoulos. Petropoulos is an unconventional researcher on Greek folk culture, and those of us who are listening to us at the moment should know Petropoulos due to the work he has conducted on Rebetito. An academic library promotes knowledge through researchers, but we firmly believe that this kind of knowledge should not be contained in the library. We should share the findings of the researchers and the unique collections of our library with the public. So we are sharing this knowledge, studying books and archives with the wider public through lectures, symposiums, exhibitions, and music events like nowadays. The library was inaugurated in 1926, and it has been based on the support of many benefactors. In the last 30 years, the overseers of Gennadios are taking care of our buildings, and they are enriching our collections, and they are also offering scholarships. The president of our overseers, Andreas Zobanis, has given a new breath of life to our council in the past 6 years by bringing new ideas for programs and events. We do apologize, there is a problem with the sound, and we are doing the best that we can. As a Greek of the diaspora, having studied in archaeology and architecture and business, Mr. Zobanakis is well-traveled. He is a world traveler, like Ioannis Gennadios would say. He is thirsty for knowledge, and he has a deep love for civilization and our culture. His vision, just like Yanadius, is to create a large Yanadius library, which will be in dialogue with researchers, academics, and the wider public through books, lessons, and music. Nowadays, on the day of his saint, his name day, Andreas Zobanakis will be organizing this conversation, and we would like to wish him for his name day and thank him for inspiring us and paving the way with new challenges. We do apologize, we can't hear very well.
Μ' ακούτε? Μαρία, ευχαριστώ. Δεν μου αξίζουν αυτά τα λόγια, αλλά τέλος πάντων, ευχαριστώ. Ο σκοπός αυτών των εκδηλώσεων είναι φυσικά να περάσουμε καλά. Να ακούσουμε ωραία μουσική, αλλά να φύγουμε από εδώ έχοντας μάθει κάτι. Εγώ δεν είμαι εθνικομουσικολόγος. Θα συντονίσω τη σημερινή βραδιά, αλλά εγώ είμαι ένας περιηγητής. Στο ταξίδι το απόψινό, ο οδηγός θα είναι ο Christopher King. Ο πασίγνωστος πια Christopher King. Τον Christopher, άκουσα πρώτη φορά τον Christopher το 2018, διαβάζοντας μια κριτική για το βιβλίο του στο New York Review of Books, ένα από τα πιο διακεκριμένα πολιτιστικά περιοδικά της Αμερικής. Το βιβλίο με το αγγλικό τίτλο «Lament from Epirus» απέσπασε ευρύτατες
Epirus is the book and it was presented to the public to great acclaim. And I ordered this book because I was intrigued. I was intrigued not only because it was a book about Epirus and its lament, and laments, and of course, Wall Street Journal, Financial Times, New York, all the literary critics had hailed it. But it was also written by an American. And it was a book that spoke in a very interesting way about his personal journey in Epirus and the discovery of its music. And this was a journey that started when he bought a 78 inches disc in Istanbul. So I had to meet him, and I looked for him on the internet, and I invited him here in Yanadios. And as Maria said, we have a rather small but important musical archive, and we also have Titanis Baglamas. The moment I held this instrument, the moment he held this instrument, he said, "Can I touch it?" And right at this moment, I saw in his face a great, he was very moved, and I understood that he was very much in love with Greek musical tradition. And since that day, we have become friends, personal friends. And of course, that was the beginning also of cooperation, collaboration that I hope will be of many fruitful years. So we have to, this is the fourth presentation we are doing here. Christopher is an ethnomusicologist that has been awarded with Grammys. I mean, we all know this is the equivalent of the Oscars for music. And in the recent years, he has created more than 300 collections. And he has worked as a specialist in digital conservation for the Library of the Congress in the United States. He has created a very detailed library of music for Southern Balkans. And of course, his contribution in making the music of Epirus known the world over was recognized last summer when he was awarded the Greek citizenship. So today, Christopher lives in Konitsa. He's currently living his dream, as one might say. And as he told me when I wished him to do what he wants in life, he said very, very, like instinctively, well, I'm living my dream. So today our musicians are Kostas Karapanos, Kostas was born in Ioannina and he's a violin player since he was 12. Of course, he holds a diploma of classical violin and he has also studied Greek traditional music, especially Epirus traditional music. Orel Kiljo. Orel was born in Albania and he studied music and he became a violin professor in Albania, in Greece and in the United Kingdom. He has also been a director in Tirana and in Korytsa. He has he knows very well the traditional music of the Balkan Peninsula. And finally, we have Mario Tumba. So Marius was born, was also born in Ioannina, and he grew up in Ioannina, and he started music and classical guitar lessons at the age of 7 years by going to the Tsakalov Conservatoire, and he started playing guitar in 2013, and since 2016 he started playing also the lute and also studying traditional music. I will be speaking now in English as well. So
about this intriguing title.
Okay.
When the violin was king.
Makus.
Sakuo.
Okay.
Telia.
Well, before I do that, three orders of business.
Okay.
Three orders of business. First of all, everybody should say Chronia Pala to Andreas.
Thank you.
Secondly, people often ask me, and it's the tone of their voice, you live in Konitsa? Why do you live there? And I always say the same thing. It's perfect. It's perfect.
There you go.
And then the last.
When you're looking for him, we can't hear you.
Okay, sorry. Okay. It's perfect. Konitsa is. And the last thing is, everybody who's from Epirus, raise your hand.
See, this time there are many that are not from Epirus, Christopher.
Okay. Well, so to explain the provocative title, those people who are familiar with the music of Greece, when you mention the word Epirus, it conjures this one thing, clarino. Everybody thinks of clarino. They automatically assume that you're infatuated with the clarino and that it gives you the deepest emotional pleasure. What we're going to be exploring tonight is this idea that our memories only go so far back as our grandparents. Our tactile memory of music is about 80 years old. Sure enough, 80 years and more has been the clarinet dominating the music of Epirus. But before then, violin was king. Violin kind of ruled the musical soundscape of Epirus. And so what I'll be doing this evening is acting as like your tour guide or your pilot.
Virgil.
I'm your Virgil, right. I'll be taking you by the hand and we will be exploring the soundscape of Epirus before the clarinet became the dominant sound. And I'll be using a combination of old 78 RPM disc recordings, some of which are about 120 years old. And then my good musical friends will be playing to demonstrate this notion of musical change that we've been witnessing. And then Andreas is going to be our interlocutor. He'll be our midwife, so to speak.
So to speak. Yeah. So how do we start the journey?
Well, I think mainly everybody who's familiar with the music of Ypres realizes there's two forms. There's social dance music, and then there are these sort of contemplative tunes like Miraloi, Skaros, table songs such as the polyphonic songs that are not danceable. When we think about this kind of music, in Ypres, and especially in Pogoni and in Konitsa, the music is dominated by the pentatonic, the use of the pentatonic scale, as well as with polyphonic singing, the use of five notes to deliver the message. So what I want to play first, and this is the only instance we'll be hearing it tonight, is this version of a Miraloi played by Nick Halkias, the slightly older brother of Tasos Halkias. This represents our musical memory. This is the kind of Miraloi that we associate with Ypres.
What's the date of this recording?
The date of this recording is 1958. 1958.
The year of my birth.
The year of your birth. Honia Pala. Elbisan. And as a very quick story before we hear the live music, I played this record once in Delvanaki, and the audience loved it so much they kept on saying, Aluena, Aluena, more, again, play it again. So I played it a second time, and then they said, more, more. I played this record three times, and then out of the mist, like some sort of vision, Kostas Verdis and his group, a famous clarinet player, walks out and they start playing the same piece. They were a surprise. And so we have a musical surprise our good friends here are going to play their version of Miraloy that's a blending of the old and the new.
So sweet, so beautiful.
Right, so we've heard what it sounds like on a clarino, we've heard what it sounds like on the violí, and what did it sound like before the violí?
Well, the violin would have been the dominant instrument for 200 years, give or take, before the overtaking by the clarinet. Before the violin, the main instrument would have been the floyera, the zamara, the shepherd's flute. And you know, before this instrument was the lead instrument, voices were the main instrument. Amiraloya is a lament. It's an expression of grief, of longing, of suffering. And one reason why I love their versions is that they're perfectly idiosyncratic. Costas's version is quite different from Orel's, but structurally they're the same. That's the fantastic thing about music, is that the artists can lend their distinctive voice. But before we discuss anything, I want to play this the shepherd's flute, which I brought one. This is about 150 years old. This came originally from the village of the town of Corcha. This was given to me by the grandson of a man who came to America. This is about 150 years old. This would have been the main instrument that would have been played before the violin. What I'm going to play now is basically a mitraloya. It's mitacare. This was recorded around 1917, 1918 in America by an artist named Pando Opengadi. It's a little faint, but we'll do what we can. Thank you.
So I have a question for you, but also for the musicians. In Erotsi ke pros ta esas. What makes a piece of music traditional? Does it evolve? Does it change? Τι κάνει τη μουσική παραδοσιακή? Κώστα, το συζητούσαμε νωρίτερα.
Κώστα, we were discussing this before. So, well, this is clearly a big discussion. What is traditional? What traditional music means? According to me, tradition is not something static, stagnant. It evolves and it is dynamic. So, of course, we take into consideration the initial performances and this big, this great music. I will be talking about the music of Epirus, so because I have studied it. So we have to learn how these first important musicians played, and we have to learn it and then add our own grain of salt and evolve the changes. Of course, I do not think that we have to, you know, copy paste the way a musician was performing 100 years ago. I mean, I think we will add our own ideas, and the ones that will come afterwards will do the same thing. So tradition can be very dynamic and not something that is stagnant and preserved in only one way. Thank you very much.
On this distinction, is it's the best way to look at it is that we think of tradition, traditional, as a thing. Like we can pick this up and say, oh, this is traditional. But that's not the case. Traditional is a process. It's some way by which we move through and we retain certain elements, and yet other elements evolve. They evolve from political pressures, from religious pressures, pressures of history or technology. But it's this process which is traditional, not the thing.
Okay.
And this is what I think we have to explore in terms of identity. We can't expect something never to change, because then it becomes a museum piece, and then it's something that dies. And I don't want this music to die.
Yep. So, Christopher, when we decided to do some musical events at the Yanagios, we set ourselves a rule that it wouldn't just be a performance, but it would also be a learning experience. So you developed this methodology that where we use old records and where we have contemporary musicians side by side. And so I'm curious, because I'm relatively new to this, what do we learn by listening to old 78s?
I mean, what I call this technique or methodology is sonic archaeology. It's not studying simply the living manifestation of a folk music, but rather the continuum, be it the continuum 100 years, 120 years. We have something that we can reference in the past, and then we can posit it in the present, and we can understand these processes that are at play, these things that are putting pressures on cultures and on music to make one thing develop one way or another. When we have access to these old recordings, it's like a snapshot of time. It's like it's an instantaneous image, an oral image of what things sounded like, a soundscape 120 years ago. It's like a photograph,
yep.
But to me, even more beautiful than a photograph.
Mm-hmm. So,
where I use this methodology is to sort of explore the things that we weren't expecting about music. You know, we often think music is very predictable. It happens in this way, it comes from this source, these lyrics come from this region, this style of playing comes from another region. We have a very neat understanding of things, but we don't. Music is full of surprises, and I think as sonic archaeologists or anthropologists or musicians or just as average people, we have to sort of acknowledge that there are questions that we can ask about music that we thought we knew the answer, but maybe it was otherwise. So what I'm going to play now is a 78, which is another Mitterloy, and then I think we're done with Mitterloy. This is like a transitional piece. This shows like just when the violin was still dominant over the over the clarinet, but also it has this fascinating ending. The ending of the piece is unexpected. It's you don't hear anything quite like this now. The ending is basically the ending of a dance piece you would hear in, say, Romania or Ukraine, being performed by Ashkenazi Jews. So there's these elements of cultural exchange going on that we hear in these old discs that we don't hear now. But by using this methodology, we can see the continuum. Maybe these pieces actually were transmitted from a different place. So this is Merko Miraloj. Merko is Albanian for more time, a lament for more time. And this is Manthos Halkias, who was the much, much older brother of Tasos Halkias, and on violin is Mitsos Halkias. In a way, they're playing a 100-year earlier style than what you hear Tasos Halkias play.
And this record dates from?
1929, recorded in Athens.
Jewish music at the end of that.
Yeah, it's like a magic trick being pulled out of your pocket.
Yeah.
I think the question that we can ask is, what is hidden in these old discs and these old ways of playing? And are there ways in which we can know about the progression of history through music by using the tools of 78s, by using photographic images? To me, one of the most interesting things that's happened is the unexpected. So just today, I get an email from a scholar, Sotirios Katsouras, who knows Kostas, and you know, he said, "What you're doing is great, but also I've discovered very similar things, that there was this pre-existing tradition of violin music in Ypres, but being played on an eight-string violin, on a sympathetic violin." And so by combing through hundreds of thousands of photographs, he found these clues that indicate that there was this tradition of making music using this eight-string violin, which now no longer exists. And much of the evidence that points to where this music comes from, the evidence is gone. You know, all we have now left are the 78s and tantalizing clues.
So what are we going to listen to now?
I want our friends to play one of my favorite songs. Kostas smiles because he knows whenever I'm in Vitsa, I always ask for this. It's the song Yenoveva, and I love to have this played into me. But as you'll hear, it's an intricate tune, and it's now readily identified with the repertoire of Ypres, but it has a surprising origin.
Λοιπόν, θα παρουσιάσουμε τη Γενοβέφα όπως μας έβαλε.
We are going to perform Yenoveva in the way that King asked us to do it, because nowadays it is played in a different way in Epiros, but Christopher has offered to us the Mitsos Chalkias version, and he told us this is the Yenoveva version you are going to play when I am with you. And Christopher is dancing Yenoveva at the Vitsa Panigiri. He doesn't even have to ask for the song. We already know. So we will try to play it. In the way that Mitsos Chalkias was performing it. Thank you.
So, Christopher, what, I mean, there's so much going on in there. What are we listening to? What's going on?
I mean, what's going on is that this melody is cast as a negris. It's that's the tonality, the scale, the mahim that's being used, which is not unusual for music of Asia Minor or of Greece, but the way in which the notes are so closely bound together, it's a slightly different version of negris. It's one you hear in Odessa and in music from Bucharest. And so when I heard this, I listened to some klezmer recordings from the 1920s that were made in America by Jewish musicians that had moved over in the 20s. And one of the pieces they play is a dance for the new bride and groom. It's the same thing. It's the same general melody, which makes me, you know, ask this profound question: how did it get from Bucharest or Odessa into Ioannina? It's generally a piece that's associated with Ioannina. Could there have been some connection between this music in Central and Eastern Europe and the Romagnotes living in Ioannina, Preveza, and Arta? I'm gonna play the 78, also by Manfos Halkias, with Mitsos on violin, and this sort of Ashkenazi feel to the piece is even more apparent.
Okay. What, and the date of this
one? Oh, this is also 1929.
What's next on her journey?
Well, where I want to take you now, just relax.
Okay.
Relax in your seat, is to me a very special tune in that It was firmly identified with the music of Ypres, especially with that of Ioannina. Had probably been played for 200 years or more, but then it died. It kind of like disappeared. It was no longer part of the repertoire. It's similar to other pieces such as Skaros. It has the same general scale structure, but this piece of music, it meant so much that there were two recordings made prior to 1943, and then after 1943, it was no longer performed as a piece. My friend Kostas first heard this recording from the recordings that I gave him of Alexis Zumas, and so he worked out his own version of Doina. So we're going to hear Doina now.
Another version?
Well, I mean, I want to talk about this piece because it's important for many reasons. This particular piece was found in the recorded repertoire in Greece in two different areas, in Macedonia around Grevina and in Ioannina. I have two recorded examples of it, but its recorded history goes back much earlier. In 1907, this was recorded in Bucharest on the shepherd's flute, on a floriera. Then it was recorded multiple times by Romanian artists, and then at this point several dozens of times by Ashkenazi Jewish groups, what you now call klezmer groups, that were all throughout Central and Eastern Europe. The doina was the prelude to a wedding. It was like what would be played to sort of call the village together before the bride and the groom would be married. These are the questions that need to be researched, that maybe we won't have the answer, but we'll have a greater understanding of our culture. How did this music from Eastern and Central Europe get into Ioannina? Ioannina was a multicultural, multi-ethnic, polyglot, cosmopolitan city. It had a constant influx of merchants. There was exchanges. There were wealthy merchants living in Romania and in Odessa that would then come back to Ioannina. They had heard music that they liked. They had heard musicians that they liked. What if they brought their own musicians with them? What if they had encountered Roma musicians and brought them into Greece, and then the repertoire that was being played in Romania also came with them? There were pieces that they liked. These are just ways, I think, of opening ourselves up to these notions that we could be shocked by music, that music has this sort of quality of not being grabbed down. As you can see from the label here, this actually references this song as a song of Ioannina. It meant so much to Alexis Zumbas, who only made 36 recordings in New York, that he recorded this. Maybe this was a piece of social music for the Romagnote. We don't know, because in 1943, the population was more or less exterminated. Nobody asked the questions, really, what their social music was like. We know what the religious music was like, but not the social music. This could be a clue. This could show us. So I'm going to play this disc, but before I do, a funny story. This is really rare. And my fixation on collecting discs is like other men's fixation with collecting blondes or empty whiskey bottles. I see a disc and I have to have it. I had a copy of this disc. The flip side is Samandakis. Mm-hmm. Okay. But as you can see, it had as a chip. Okay. I had this copy, and then I was at my good friend Vaso's house going through her 78s in Morista, outside of Konietzka, and I saw this copy that was pristine, and I was practically weeping at the sight of it, and she took mercy on me, and she let me have it.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, so anyway, this is Doina by Alexis Zumbas. This is 1927, recorded in New York City.
Okay, so we've heard a lot of contemplative, if I can pronounce it, music.
Contemplative.
Contemplative, there you go, contemplative music.
For once, English actually serves me well here.
It does. So what about dance music? Does dance music undergo the same kind of transformation?
Yes, I mean, I think at an earlier time, certain artists really spaced out their music. They really developed these themes, and so 200, 300 years ago, certain pieces that are fast now were quite slow back then. Mm-hmm. And we're going to hear the next one is Selfo, which is a piece that sort of showcases the violin. Nowadays, it's played as a slightly faster zamico, but 100 years ago or more, it was more of a slow piece. So we'll hear Selfo. Thank you. So this is the current way in which Selfo is performed in most villages for Panieri. It's a faster tzamiko. But 100 years ago, it had this almost grandiose quality, like it was a regal piece. And this is recorded by Mitsos Halkias, 1928. And to me, this is the ballsiest of all the recordings ever made from that time period. Andreas, a lot of the pieces that we've been listening to are firmly identified with Ypres and with this tradition, and yet there's another body of songs and dances which are cross-border. They exist throughout the Southern Balkans, and each of the musicians here has picked their own tunes that sort of represent this this sort of multi-tribal and cross-border tunes that exist.
Yeah, and I was going to ask the musicians, τι εξηγεί την πρωτιά του κλάδου.
How could you possibly explain that the clarinet became dominant, and clarinet being dominant, why did you choose the violin? Okay. First of all, the clarinet players in Epiros, because we're going to discuss about what is happening in Epiros. Therefore, we should congratulate clarinet players of all times who have managed to reach such a level of skill that could please everybody. And my best man, Kotsinis, is here with us today, one of the best clarinet players in Greece. And I have spoken so highly of him because I would like him to offer me jobs. Because as you know, in Epiros, you have to be a clarinet player in order to find work as a musician. No, no, this is not a joke. This is the actual truth. I started to learn how to play the clarinet due to my body shape. I was a kind of a small boy. My fingers were thin. And since the age of 12, I was asking my father to take me to violin lessons. And my father was telling me, I'm not going to turn you into a gypsy. And there are village people here from my village who can testify to the truth of my words. And to be honest, I am not as young as I look. I was born in the 70s, and even till the 80s, people used to think that music is only played by gypsies. These are the only ones who play instruments. So when I became 12 years of age, I managed my father to allow me to have music lessons. And I love the violin when it is being played in the local panegyria, these musical, religious musical festivals. There was some people who were very good, Vangelis, Yannis Panou, and I loved playing the violin. And then I went to a music academy to learn how things are done, because this Jan Telis was a friend of my father's. And I said to my dad, Dad, ask him to come and teach me how to play the violin. And he taught me the Genoveva song, because that was the truth. I couldn't really play the tune on the violin, even though I was attending a music academy. I couldn't play the tune because I couldn't know how traditional players were actually performing. And they were keeping the secret from themselves and their families. They would not give away the secret to other people. So he gave me a class. I understood a little bit what was happening. And I asked my dad to bring him back. And I was asking for him to come back. Will he come to show me? And my dad told me, Andreas, I am not the person to teach your son. Your son is going to be our teacher. So from what he was saying, he actually wanted to keep the secret for himself. He didn't want the secret to spread. And in my generation, technology was not so evolved. In order to play Genoveva, first I needed to listen to it on a tape recorder. And I was going backwards and forwards. And it took me more than a week to learn how to play this tune. And now a modern musician can learn the piece in a couple of classes. It was very difficult for us to understand how folk music was being played, because it's not enough to play the notes. You need to transmit the feeling. You have seen that we have almost played the same tunes with Alexis Tsoumbas or Tasos Halkias. And whom did you like the most? Alexis and Mitsos. We are trying to reach them. We are trying to play like them, but it is not possible. So we are doing things in our personal style. We are using technology. We are playing the tunes a little bit slow, but we are also adding our personal touch, because we believe that tradition should evolve. And this is what they also did. First of all, I would like to say that the Epirus traditional music is a folk music. It's oral music spread by word of mouth. They were listening to it, and we were also listening to them. But now we've got young people, real scientists, who can record this music or write it down in order to be studied. But how to play this music, this is not something you can learn through a piece of paper. You have to come into contact with traditional musicians. If you want to learn Greek, you have to really study it, and even then, you won't speak like a native speaker. And I would also like to sing Aurel's praises. He's my friend. We've worked twice in the past together, and it's amazing how giving and cooperative he is, because when you are playing the same instrument, there is also a sense of competition and jealousy. But I would like to thank him because he has taught me so much. I don't want to speak any further. I will pass the floor to Aurel. But it is possible for us to spread this kind of music and help it evolve. And it is a kind of our own cultural product, especially in Epirus, which is a poor area. And we could render it into a global good for sale. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. Won't be speaking long. So only two words. It is a great honor to be playing here, and I would like to thank you all for attending and honoring us, and especially Mr. Andreas, who decided to host this event, because for me this is very important. What do I mean? What is Epirus? I came to Greece in the 90s. I had finished my studies in university. I had studied violin and orchestral direction, and I had learned some Epirus, Northern Epirus music. So when I came to Greece, I understood that Epirus is one. And 400, 500 years of the Ottoman Empire and the Turkish afterward, they couldn't bring down this music. And the music is pentatonic. It doesn't use the seven notes. If that was the case, well, then we wouldn't be here talking about the music of Epirus, and maybe it would have been called differently. Why do I say that? I've worked for 20 years as a music professor in Greece. I have taught violin in the conservatoires, but I realized that all Balkan music, Greece, Albania, Skopje, Serbia, Montenegro, and Romania and Moldova, Bulgaria, they're all actually, the music has changed because there was the Ottomans. I don't mean it badly. I mean, they just, you know, mix things up in music. Because why? They were using seven notes. But these seven notes were not what we call A, B, C, D, E, F. So these were the Greek mode, the Aeolian, Ionian, Dorian, and the Ottomans. I mean, they could, you know, change this music. They inserted their stuff, and it sounds good. I mean, island music, everywhere. It's only the Epirus music that remained as it was, and this is how we played. There were just a few tweaks and changes all around Epirus, but the core, in its core, it is pentatonic. And we are thank God we are blessed to have this beautiful music. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Good evening. Two musicological elements that I would like to highlight as I am a PhD candidate in musicology. So for this event and about violin, because I have next to me two violin players, we could start a huge discussion about why there's no clarinet, or clarino as we call it in Greece, and we have two violins. We can go back in history. I don't think we should be talking about whether clarinet or violin is king or is dominant, as Andrea said. But what we have to underline is that clarinet was actually an innovation when it first appeared in tradition. And tradition is a living organism. So it's not cut living apart from society. And this is why now we have clarinet as the main instrument. In the past, we had violin. And once the Ottomans came in, the Greek space in the Greek in Greece, they inserted clarinet. It was a very strong instrument. It was very loud, and since there was not the technology to amplify sound, there is no sound amplification. So these two instruments started coexisting, and we don't know what might happen in the future. We must keep some pillars of the music at least stable, and we shouldn't change what we call the Epirus idiom, the Epirus musical language. Thank you very much. Now we are nearing the end, and we have asked the musicians to each choose a piece that they want to play and to present to us why they chose it, what we will be hearing. So the first one is Ali Pasha, right? So we all know Ali Pasha, right? I mean, the audience here, they know Ali Pasha. We shouldn't go into all the historical details. And for Greeks and southern Albania, I mean, at the time when Ali Pasha was slaughtered, people were lamenting his death because they felt unprotected. Because for many years with Ali Pasha, they felt relatively safe. They were not paying taxes and duties, so things were good. But he was slaughtered. He was killed. So one of the Northern Epirus song, it's from Albania, and I will be singing it here. Orel is saying the lyrics in Albanian. The head in Istanbul, the body in Ioannina, Ali Pasha, you were slaughtered, you were slaughtered. One grave could not hold the whole of your glory, but also of your cruelty. You were slaughtered, Ali Pasha.
Πασατεστίνε.
The next song that I'm sorry, I don't know if I can pronounce it. Can I say something? No. Do you want to say? I would like to say why I have chosen the piece. So it's called Arvanitico. So I wanted to, highlight, support Aurel because he Ali Pasha was an Arvanites. So this is a very a piece that requires great dexterity, and then we'll be playing Arvanito Vlachiko together with Aurel, which is also a relevant piece of music.
You're not going to do this. Thank you.
like it is ours.
So, since this is my name day and they told me I can ask for whatever I want, I asked for Isokratises. So, this is my request on my name day.
I'm going to sit and enjoy down here.
What?
I'm going to sit here and enjoy.
Thank you.
Ευχαριστούμε.
Thank you very much. And this is the way we arrived at the end of an unforgettable evening. Thank you very much.
Beautiful.
Να πάνε και με κάποια από εκεί.